Good morning.
Rick, how you doing?
It's good to see you.
Doing well.
Praise God. It's good to see everyone's face here this morning. Praise the Lord. My wife and I, we're so glad to be able to come back and be with you folks once again. And it's such a privilege and an honor to be with you once again today. So it's wonderful. And so if we can just take a moment there before we come to worship, I just want to open in prayer this morning. Amen?
Amen.
Heavenly Father, in Jesus' precious and glorious name, Father, we have come into your house, Father, to give you praise, glory, and honor, all that is due you. And Father, we welcome and invite your presence in such a wonderful and tangible way this morning, Father. We ask that we would be able to reach out and touch you this morning, Father. Father, we ask that, Father, you would bring forth the healing, Father, in our lives that is necessary. That you would bring forth the inspiration in the spiritual life of each person here this morning, that, Father, you would encourage us today to be in your likeness in every way. Father, we thank you, and we thank you for being here today. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. Amen. Praise our Lord. Hallelujah. Charity, let's go to a time of worship. If you desire, we may all stand, but whatever is comfortable for you this morning, I prefer to stand. Amen?
Holy Spirit,
Welcome.
Thank you, Lord.
I believe in life is good, Lord. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Let that take place here in our lives, Lord. Father, loose your spirit in our lives. Let revival come. Father, spring up the wells that well up with revival, O God. And Father, let the waters release the rivers in the bellies, O God. That, Father, we would flow in your spirit in Jesus' name. Father, let revival come. Hallelujah. Glory. Glory. Hallelujah. Praise our Lord. Hallelujah. Oh no, don't be sorry.
The atmosphere is changing now.
start sitting down. For those of you that want a fresh touch this morning, the presence of the Lord is so overwhelming this morning. It's wonderful. If you need a fresh touch in your life, I ask you to come forward right now. Just come forward. It may be something new to you, maybe something fresh, maybe something you've never ever done. But praise the Lord. If you want a fresh touch in your life, if you just want to come forward, maybe things have been dry. Maybe things haven't been the experience that you've never come in close to the presence of the Lord and you want more. Amen? Maybe it's something that you just want to release in your life this morning and just have bring out in Jesus' name. We want to pray for that this morning. Amen? We want to pray that it breaks out in our lives and that the Lord brings refreshing. He brings times of refreshing and He brings filling. Amen? He fills these vessels with an overwhelming love that just overflows to others. Then it brings forth love that surpasses all wicked and bad things. Amen? Hallelujah. And He wants to release that in our lives. Amen? He wants to do so. I feel a whole change coming in this sermon. Amen? Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, in Jesus' precious and glorious name, Father, we just ask in Jesus' name that You would loose Your Spirit in their lives here this morning, Father, in a freshness, in an infilling, Lord God, that they have yet to experience, Lord God. That, Father, You would refresh, just like a fresh spring that springs up, oh God, spring it up in them this morning in Jesus' name. Glory, fill them up this morning, Lord God, and let the joy of the Holy Ghost come forth in such a glorious and wonderful way. Father, we speak healing in the name of Jesus for the things that need to be healed. We speak glorious, wonderful things to come forth in the miraculous things of Jesus Christ that only Jesus can bring forth. Father, we loose in them today those things, those new things in Jesus' name. We thank You, oh God. Revival come. Revival come here in our lives. Revival come here in this place. Revival come into the places that are dry and dead, oh God, and revive our land. Revive our people in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Bless them today in Jesus' name. Glory! Let's give them glory this morning. Hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. Yes, Lord.
God, talk about the new wine.
Yeah.
New wine, you know, who in the old dove. Because then it was reserved to a good wine. So new wine gonna be go yeah. away. And then God will fill you up with the
new skins,
wine.
New fresh wine skins.
So new bottle, fresh new wine.
Yeah.
So Father, Lord God, fill them up
yes,
with new wine.
Yes.
This time, new wine.
Yes,
in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Glory. Hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, you said it, sister, you feel a new strength, amen?
Yeah.
There's a boldness. You know, the disciples prayed for boldness, and they received boldness in the Holy Ghost. And when they did, they went forth in power, amen? We want to go forth in the power of the kingdom of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I'm excited, are you? I'm just getting warmed up. Thank You, Lord. This morning, it's just so exciting. I love worship. And if you'll forgive me, there's going to be a little change in the service this morning, okay? You see your bulletin, you see things that are written down, but you know what? Sometimes the Lord just wants to release freedom in us, amen? You know, though He puts things in place, there are times when Jesus just wants to release in us a newness and a freshness and get us off that shelf. Blow the dust off of us and have us walk in power. Amen?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. This morning, it's a perfect interlude for my wife this morning. And just before we go to prayer, I just want to say, my wife had already, several days ago, the Lord already gave her inspiration for Samson this morning. A new strength, as it were. Samson went through a lot of things, and my wife will share that. But this morning, we've also gone through a lot of things. Amen? We've had struggles. We've had temptations. We've had the pricking of the enemy coming constantly at us, just trying to destroy our walk in Jesus. Amen? But Jesus is faithful to cause us to walk in power. Amen? He is underfoot, and he is to stay underfoot. And the only time he gets out from underneath there is when we pick our foot up and let him out. We need not to do that. Amen? And the Lord always gives to us a word that awaits us even before it goes to the crowds. Amen? I want to take a time and continue in prayer, if we will. If we can bring today's morning's prayers there. The basket's still up here, right? Yeah, the basket's still up here. If there's prayers that you have this morning, and you know what? Even if you don't have time to write them down, the basket's here. I want you to just picture yourself writing out your prayer need, placing it in the basket. The Lord knows what it is. This basket may appear empty, but in my eyes, it appears full. Amen? Because Jesus takes the prayers we have deep within our heart, and he places them. Al, you got something? Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah, my two younger prayer partners aren't here this morning. Jenny's two boys, huh? All right. Al, you want to come up with me? And after you get whatever prayers there are. And I'm gonna keep speaking this morning. My wife said, "Are you gonna be talking a lot?" And that's for me, that's how it's gonna happen. Hallelujah. The joy in the Holy Spirit, when it begins to bubble up, I can't even contain it. Amen. Because it's so exciting and so wonderful. You know, I just as you're doing that, Al, this is a perfect interlude prior to the sermon this morning that I'm going to be speaking with this morning in terms of an object lesson. It applies to prayer. It applies to our walk with Jesus. It applies to our hunger and thirsting for righteousness. Amen? And I just want to show you what lack of hunger and thirst looks like. Now, isn't that a beautiful plant, huh? Yes. Look at that baby. This is a Christian who doesn't have the desire and the thirsting and the hungering to receive from Jesus the filling that's due that Christian. Amen? That's so sad, isn't it? That looks like a crop that's been wiped out. Amen? But you know, unfortunately, this is what a lot of the church looks like. This is what the church today looks like in many ways. Now, I'm not speaking about those that are filled with power in the Holy Ghost and walking with Jesus in power and might. That's not the church I'm talking about. I'm talking about those that have become lukewarm. I'm talking about those that have turned their backs on Jesus and do not have a hunger and thirsting for righteousness. And that's what I'm going to be talking about this morning. There, I'm going to put that up there up further. And I'm not going to tell you who watered that plant. Especially you growers that grow wonderful plants here, amen? Now there's three of them here, amen? The robes of righteousness, right? There's three, Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. There's three of them there. And dressed in white, amen? Those of us that love the Lord will have robes of righteousness in Him, amen. In Jesus Christ. A white and beautiful robe, you know? And he comes on a white horse too, doesn't he? Jesus rides a white horse. Faithful and true, amen? I just saw a rerun of The Lone Ranger and that white horse just rising up, you know? I'm old-fashioned. I like a lot of that old stuff. But I like what's coming new and fresh, amen? So look at this. This I want to see as you folks, amen? That it dressed in robes of righteousness and it's rising up with beauty and freshness in your lives. Amen? Hallelujah. So I'm going to put those object lessons right up here. I'm going to put this, let's see, right hand of the Lord right there. Amen. We'll put this sad one on the left. Amen. That kind of lines up, doesn't it? Alrighty. Al, you want to bring forth the prayers and stand with me? It's good to see you, my brother. Hallelujah. What do we got here? Let's see, friend Alex to nursing?
Pass.
From passing a test?
Yep.
Oh, passing a test, okay. And that's for Alex, right? And a son with an uncontrolled high blood pressure, another son that needs a knee surgery. Okay. All right, we'll put those right to the Lord. We'll put our hand right over right now. Heavenly Father, in Jesus' precious name, Father, we bring these prayer requests to you in Jesus' name. And Father, we speak healing, Father, that you would take these children with the high blood pressure and the surgery of the knee, Father, and just bring forth, Father, the wonderful healing that only you can bring. I ask for a completely restored knee, and I ask for blood pressure that is perfectly normal according to the way that you created it, in Jesus' name. And Father, for the friend of Alex that needs to pass this test, Father, for nursing, I ask that you would grant to them, Father, the wonderful grades necessary to accomplish what needs to be done. That they would come forth with flying colors, Father, that they would do well on this test. Be a perfect piece as they take it, and come be overjoyed when they find out the result, that it's a good one and a good report. We thank you. And Father, for this church this morning, Father, we ask that you continue to fill this church body, Father, with the overflowing presence of your love, grace, and mercy here this morning. We thank you for the healing touch that you give each and every one of us. We thank you for the refreshing in your Holy Spirit that you bring to us. Father, we ask for the encouragement, the strength, and the boldness to go forth into that deadened world as the light and salt that you send forth in Jesus' name to bring forth all to you, Father, that you would bring all the lost once again to you in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for your blessing. We thank you for your salvation in Jesus' precious name. And everyone said, amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Al. Love you, brother. Praise our Lord. I'll set those right up there. All right, I'm going to ask my wife now at this time to come and speak to the children. And there will be children's shirts, and Karen's going to be having it afterwards so they can be released afterwards. But my wife would like to tell you about Samson this morning. Amen.
Melody, come again.
Hi. Wow. You're only one here. The last shall become first. Wonderful. Well, I'm going to tell you the story today about Samson. And if you want to know the story about Samson, you can go to the book of Judges, chapter 13, 14, 15, and 16. If you want to read more about Samson. Samson was the man that God chose to do work for him. He was born in his mother's womb, and when he came out, God told his parents, do not cut his hair. So razor never come close to his head, so his hair grew long. That could let the people know that he belonged to God, and God will use him. Like anything else, Samson fall and sin, and he met this woman, a Philistine woman named Delilah, and he fell in love with her. But before that, Samson so strong, he can wrestle the lion and fight the lion and rip the lion's mouth with his bare hand. And then again, he was so angry when the first wife that he married, they decided to leave, and he was mad. So he was double, and he killed 1,000 men. That's how strong he is. And then later on, that when Goliath come in, she asked him three questions. Tell me your secret about your strength. But Samson did not want to tell her the secret. So he deceived her three times. So Delilah said, you don't love me, you don't tell me the truth. Tell me what gave you the strength. So he finally told Delilah. And Delilah waited until he sleep. And she went and cut his hair. When he woke up, he was weak. No longer he can fight. So the Philistine come and capture him and bound him. They arrest him. The Philistine did a mean thing to him. They took his eye out. So now he's blind. So he bound with two big pillows, one on the left, one on the right. Samson prayed to God one more time. Lord God, give me the strength. This time, he prayed to God. And God told him, and God helped him. And he pushed that big pillar with a holding for the big castle, and they all fall down. And the people was on it, they all get killed. 3,000 people died that day. He killed more people that day than all the other days of his life. God used him, and he did what God wanted him to do. A lesson for us all to learn. Sometimes we have the strength, and sometimes we don't have the strength. We too can be like Samson, call out to God and help us. When our day falling apart, when you have a bad day in school, all you do to call Jesus, help me, and he will be there for you. We can be strong in spirit, much better than physical strong. But if we can have the physical strong, that's awesome way to have. There was a time that my husband, he moved the shed all by himself. I don't know how he did it, but I did know the Holy Spirit helped him, because there's no way he can move the big shed all by himself. He did it all by himself. Holy Spirit, the one that helped him. He did that all by himself. So you see, you can be strong physical too, you don't even know it. But what we want the most is be strong in spirit, because that's better gift for us to have. So learn to call out to God when you go weary. He too can keep you strong like Samson. Okay? God bless you and God keep you. In the name of Jesus Christ I pray. Amen.
Now, may go to your children's church this morning with Karen, amen? You like it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Mike. Praise our Lord. Let's take just a moment and go back to a short time of worship out of the hymn book there together, and let's stand and let's see. 240. Let's turn to 240 together. Let's stand and sing together. All together, let's sing. Yeah, the one that loves you. then we'll go to our sermon. Amen. That need to be made that I don't know about.
No?
Okay. All right. Praise our Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. This morning I'm excited. There, Charity, let me ask you, did you also have the Beatitudes on screen?
Yeah, Gallery put them up.
I did Matthew 5. I didn't do the reading in the
hymn. Okay. All right. Let's turn to the book there. And that was... let's see, 589, right? I believe it's 589.
Yeah, 589.
Okay. Thank you. And I want to take and read this together this morning, if we can, as a body, as a corporate body. Amen. Now, when he saw the crowds, he went up on a mountain and sat down. His disciples came to him and began to teach him, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Amen. Lord, bless the reading of your word this morning. Hallelujah. This morning we're going to take a closer look this morning there, and once again, I'm going to get close. Amen? I'm coming down. Hallelujah. I love this part. This morning, I'm going to pose a couple questions here this morning to you this morning in looking at that passage starting in chapter 5 from verse 1 to 12. Amen? And this morning, I want you to see some things through your spiritual eyesight this morning. God has given you two sets of eyes. Amen? One that's in your soul, and another set that feeds to your soul is your physical eyes. Amen? And I want to dig deep this morning, if we can, and have a look at what it means to be drawing closer to Jesus. Amen? Our actions. And what I want to take a look right in the first two verses there, and I'm going to read those once again, starting 1 and 2. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain. I mean, I'm reading out of the King James. And when he was set, I like that, when he was set, his disciples came unto him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, amen, the spoken word. So what did Jesus do? I made a note here. I'm going to ask these questions this morning. What did he, being Jesus, do? As the first question. What did he actually do? And number two, who was the audience he was addressing at first? Amen? Now, when you think of the Beatitudes, you think of all the multitudes standing at the base of the mountain, do you? But how often do you think of the fact that first he brought the disciples? First, he taught them speaking the word. Amen? Here in the body of Christ, we are meant to be disciples of Jesus, are we not? Amen. For those that truly want to follow him wholeheartedly and with a hunger and thirsting. And number three, what was their response to him? That being that of the disciples I'm speaking of. What was their response? I've got a few notations in here for you that will address that. And starting with Jesus himself, and seeing the multitudes, he saw the people. That's the very, very first thing Jesus did, is he looked out and he saw who was out there. Amen? Jesus sees every one of us today. He not only sees the multitudes, but he sees his disciples. Amen? He's looking to see who his audience is. Amen? Who's out there waiting to hear from him? And number two, he went up into a mountain. I love this part because he set himself. Amen? Jesus brought himself alone up into the mountain, and he made ready himself and set himself in preparation to meet his disciples. To meet his disciples. Now, who comes next? He, when he was set, here comes the disciples. Came the disciples unto him. The action of disciples were that they had to go to him. How often is it today that the church expects and people expect that Jesus needs to come to them all the time? If you're in a manner of desire and seeking the Lord, we are to seek him. Amen. We are to come forth. We are to go up. You know, that was a word that my wife received from the Lord, to come up. Amen? To come up. We need to come up to him. Amen? He's seated at the right hand of the Father. We need to come into the bold room, boldly into the throne room of grace, and come boldly walking in. Amen? He's given us that opportunity. It's not a standoffish thing with him to all those that will come and be drawn by his Holy Spirit into his presence. He came to us to bring to us life. Amen? He sought you out first. He hunted us out and sought us when we were in our sins, totally walking in the opposite direction of him and far away. Jesus came and sought us. He saw us. He saw us right where we were. He viewed us with his very eyes, and he saw us. Amen? Now it's our turn to go to Him. Amen? It's our turn to thirst and hunger for righteousness. I'm going to point that out this morning. Verse 6 especially, there's no lessening in any one of these verses that Jesus spoke because it's His word. But there's a highlight, I believe, in 6. And an importance, a foundational kingdom importance in verse 6 that means something specially to you. Amen? And the reason being is because He said, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst for righteousness. First of all, whose righteousness are we hungering for? We're hungering for Jesus' righteousness in us. Because we are called to be in His likeness as He is. He is our example as Christians walking after Him in every bit of His likeness. It's given in the Word who He is, what He looks like, what He does, and how He does it is our objective example for us as believers in Jesus Christ to obey Him and follow Him as He was. Amen? In righteousness. And I love this part especially, for they shall be filled. Amen. We prayed this morning for an infilling. Amen. That's not a one-shot kind of a deal. Amen. A refilling and an infilling is a continuous thing as we walk as believers in Jesus Christ in our walk daily. Amen. I've said it before, I can't remember if I said it here or not, but if we're true living Christians, we leak. And you're going to ask me, well, what do you mean we leak? Out of these bellies flow rivers of living water. Where is the headwaters? At the throne of Christ. Amen? And those waters, those headwaters, flow into us and out of us. So by rights, if we're living a Christian life, we're leaky Christians because rivers of living waters are flowing out of these bellies, right? Amen? If for 1 minute your fields and your crops that God has given you here to raise for others to feed them, if the water runs dry, what happens? It looks just like this plant over here. Dead. Has no life. If the soil and the feed to that soil is gone, it becomes dead. Amen? The whole feeding of Jesus Christ to His believers is so highly important that we need to seek righteousness. Amen? To desire it and want it. Amen? Hallelujah. I love the fact when I begin to bubble. Amen? Hallelujah. And after this, out of coming up into His presence, the disciples gather around Him. And you can picture Jesus, He sat there. He's comfortable. He's prepared. He sought the Father already. And He knows exactly what He's going to say to His disciples. This is before speaking to the multitude. Now, the multitude was there at the base of that mountain. They heard the message of the Beatitudes, did they not? It was said that they all heard what was to be said. But how many of the multitude do you hear about thereafter? You hear about the disciples, don't you? You hear about how God used them in their walk and drew them close. So who gets the message first? Did not the prophets hear the word of the Lord first? Did not the disciples hear the word of the Lord first? Did not believers and followers of Jesus Christ, us in the body of Christ today, do we not hear from God first? By rights, if things work the way they're supposed to, we hear from God. Because we are, I love this, we're sheep. Everybody go, ah. We're sheep, absolutely. But praise God. He's the head shepherd. And His sheep, us, hear His voice. When people tell you they're not hearing the voice of Jesus, something is wrong. Because either they're not following Him and they're not His sheep, or something is wrong in their spiritual life that has shut down their hearing. Amen? Because all the time, I truly believe, Jesus is speaking. He speaks the spoken word to us, and he speaks it into our lives. He speaks it into our hearts, our souls, and our minds, and he causes us to flourish like that triple beautiful plant over here in white, and he gives us a robe of righteousness in white. Amen? Because Jesus and us and we and him have that availability to be clothed in righteousness. Hallelujah. I believe it's glorious. Blessed are. And that's the way it's written here in the word. But we can also say, blessed I am. Amen? Blessed I am because I've received from Jesus all of what he has said we are. Amen? All that he says to us, all that he speaks to us. Hallelujah. And I want to describe just a little bit in the Greek plural, in the marikario there in the Greek, that indicates this type of blessing. When you speak of blessing, most people speak of it in the general term of blessing. But I want you to see here in the Greek plural, according to this word and this passage, what it indicates. It indicates in the Greek, it indicates the fullness of the blessing that sustains a disciple of Jesus in difficult circumstances or persecution. We, as a body of Christ, can expect nothing else less than persecution and all kinds of things coming of against us because of he. Because if it came to him, I guarantee you it's going to us. We are to receive no less than what he received. Amen? Jeffrey, we laugh about what we, in kind of a sad, kind of hurting kind of way, the persecutions that we go through. Amen? And you know, I think about Paul's response to that, because he was joyful and excited even in the persecutioning, even in the hard times, because wonderful works of God come forth out of that. Amen? And when we begin to see it with a different look and a different eyesight of the outcome, now as we step into it, it looks pretty doggone bad. I'm not gonna shadow it in any way. It just looks nasty. Because when things come against us, they come to, whether it's Satan doing it directly, or he's got one of his hordes doing it, or it's just us being in this evil world happening to us and walking through it, it's no picnic by any means. And I prefer going through a picnic with a family of believers than I would walking through that. But Paul began to see it in a whole different way, because it was God working in him the righteousness out of all that. Amen? And it includes a sense of spiritual well-being because of one's relationship to Jesus that includes his love, his care, his salvation, and daily presence. Amen? His love, his caring. Jesus has got his arms around us under those wonderful wings of love, and he's got us wrapped in there. And I don't care what we're walking through, he goes with us. Whether we step into the furnace like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did, there's a fourth man standing in there. Amen? And his name is Jesus. I don't care how hot it gets. I don't care how many trees have fallen. I don't care how many things stand there and don't look like they're moving. God's going to move something. When it seems impossible, that's when Jesus steps in. When it seems like nothing can be done, that's where Jesus takes over. When it seems like our life can go absolutely nowhere, is when Jesus can show you how it can. Amen? Our outlook and our atmosphere and the very things that surround us and our vision thereof have to see it as Jesus sees it. Amen? We have to look past the circumstances and see the outcome. We got to do it through the Spirit that lives within us, that looks surpassing all that stuff and says, I got a blessing through all this. Well, I can't see it right now, Lord, because it looks pretty dim. But you know, when things are the blackest, things are the darkest, it's that when the light shines the brightest. Amen? When it looks like everything has gone to dark black, Jesus shines bright. Hallelujah. The foundational requirement for a godly living is to hunger and thirst. That's foundational for a believer in Jesus Christ. If we're not hungering, if we're not thirsting, there's a deadness that has set in our spiritual man. Because our spiritual man, our spiritual woman, as it were, remember, woman came from the right rib, right? Out of the rib. And it was placed into a living being. Amen. And that became woman out of the rib of man. So we're one and the same when Jesus speaks to us. Amen. Hallelujah. I want to give you three examples of that, of those that hungered, being Moses in Exodus 33:13. Moses was a hungerer and a thirster. The psalmist in the Psalms, who wrote those beautiful songs and praises and stuff, a hungerer and thirster for Jesus. Paul, the Apostle Paul, again, a hungerer and a thirster for the things of heaven, for the things of Jesus, for his kingdom to come. Amen. The spiritual conditions throughout the lives will depend on your thirsting and hungering. Because if you want to be watered and filled, it's going to depend on how thirsty and hungry you are. Jesus sets before us a table, a bounty table, that is full and vast. Amen. And those who come to the banqueting table can enjoy all that's set before them. But do you know how many people refuse coming to that table? I don't need to go there. I can do this on my own. I can accomplish everything in self. I got news for you. Self dies. Self is dead. And it doesn't last. Because it's not sustained. The sustaining power of God is in the things that we hunger and thirst for that are right. That are right before God. Amen? It says, if we search for the kingdom of God first, and his righteousness, as it says in chapter 6, all these things will be. Oftentimes they leave out the and the righteousness. We seek the kingdom of God first and his righteousness. Then all those things are added unto us. Amen? It's amazing how many things get left out. Little single words, little passages of words. Just it changes the very meaning of what Jesus said. Amen? We're not to add a tittle or a jot and tittle to the word. We're not to take away a jot and tittle to the word. It's complete. As is. He created it. He put it together. He set it forth. He bound it together. And there it is. Beginning and the end. Amen. For this reason, it's absolutely essential for us as Christians and believers in Christ Jesus to be sensitive to the Holy Ghost. You know why? Because he's given us a Holy Ghost to teach us what is right and what is not right. Amen. And our sensitivity to the Holy Spirit is one that receives a certain amount of tenderness, acuteness, and wantingness to hear what he has to say. We're never left alone. Amen? But I hear a lot of people say, I don't hear a thing. Well, that's sad, because there's something that's wrong. Either their heart was never given to Jesus, or if it was, the enemy came and stole the seed away and they're not walking with Christ anymore. Or for whatever circumstance, something in this world has taken away from what they originally started with. Amen? You know, there's a lot of people that start and never finish. I've done a lot of things in my life that I started but never finished. And I have a lovely wife over there who reminds me well of it. But praise the Lord, little by little, you know, God is patient. Amen. And I thank the Lord for his patience, because with me, he needs an extraordinary amount of patience to see that I complete all that I'm supposed to complete. Amen. But he's never without, and he's always with. He's always with us, and he's never to leave us. Amen. And we're not alone. If we truly recognize what he says in the word, we have his promise that we're never alone. Amen. Amen. It may seem to us on the outside and standing in this world that we have no one we could turn to. Well, he placed the Holy Spirit into this world to be present in us. There is someone we can turn to. Amen? I want to take just a brief moment. In Matthew 6, it says, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." I'd like to remind you of that once again. And I also want you to remind you of what destroys. We have an adversary who's against us. He's been against us since he fell from heaven, since he was created by God and turned. And he's been against us. He's been against God. He's been against his son. He's been against us ever since the beginning. And he still tries to do every thing he can to pull the rug out from underneath us. But I got news for you. If we're standing on his head, there ain't nothing he can do. Amen? He may bite our heels, but he ain't going to get far. Amen? So I want to explain some of the things that come against those very things I just spoke of, and that's worldly anxiety. The deceitfulness of wealth in this world. There's a hungering that substitutes the truth and mimics that people begin to thirst for other than Jesus. One is the riches of this world and the wealth thereof, and the anxiety that goes with all of it. Amen? And another thing is the desire for things of this world. Things that are in this world that have no kingdom value whatsoever, because when we go, they're gone too. You can't take them with you. You can't walk into heaven with them. There's that old story about the believer that decided to fill his pockets with gold. And he got up to the gates of heaven. And St. Peter looks at him and he said, "What'd you bring the pavement for? We walk on gold up here. It has no worth up here." You know? That kind of gold doesn't matter. Jesus mocks on that. You see, our value system is so different from what God's riches are. Amen? The enemy can't break in and steal what we place up in heaven. And when we place our riches there, we got something to hold on to. Amen? It can't be broken and stolen into. And also, life's pleasures. No one can tell you that the enemy doesn't give us lots of pleasure here in this world, according to this world. But it's not rightful pleasure. It's not the pleasure that's going to keep you out of a sinful nature. It's not the kind of pleasure that's going to give you a close relationship with Jesus. It's not the kind of pleasure that can deliver you from sickness. It's not the kind of pleasure that you can look back on and say, "I'm so glad I kept that." And another thing, which is extremely important, is failure to abide in Christ himself. Those are all destroyers of our walk with Jesus Christ. A failure to abide in his everlasting love. We need to abide in Christ. That means our daily walk with him is so precious that he wants us there every single day. He wants us in our secret place, the war room, as it were. My wife and I just watched that the other night again. What a great movie. In our prayer, in the presence of God, when you get in with him and our reward comes outside the closet door. Amen? When we bring all our hurtful pain before him and sit at his feet, Mary had the wonderful pleasure of sitting at his feet. Martha was so busy. She wasn't doing anything that was wrong. She was busy cooking. She was busy trying to bring a blessing to all others. But she was lacking the most important thing that Mary found, and that's sitting at the feet of Jesus while he was there. Hearing from her heavenly Father in the presence. You know, how many times is it in church when the presence comes in and you can feel Jesus walk through the door and all of a sudden, whatever it was, sets it off and sends the Spirit back out again. rather than inviting that spirit and containing that spirit and accepting what Jesus is releasing from within and getting captivated in the presence of God. Why am I here? I got to go home and fix the lawnmower. I'm going to have to mow the lawn today. Why don't you sit here and talk to Jesus? The heck with the lawn, right? I'm going to have to shovel my driveway. Is it going to make any difference the time that it takes between you going home now and shoveling the driveway versus later? You're still going to have to shovel the driveway. But won't it be a whole lot easier when you get to the driveway after spending time with Jesus, when he gives you that extra strength and sends angels on the end of your shovel to help you shovel? You know, my wife told a true story. That's absolutely true. I did move that shed with nothing there but the angels there to help me in God's presence to carry that shed. I literally picked the shed up, and Mom was, she couldn't understand it because she couldn't see what I saw at the other end helping me. It's amazing what God can deliver to you at a time of need when we trust in him and we say, God, I can't carry this. And he goes, I know. That's why I'm here. I know you can't carry this. Why do you think I'm here? I'm here to help you and to bless you. I'm here to bring those blessings that I spoke of in the Beatitudes. Blessed are those who will. Amen. And all of that goes together. Amen. Because we receive the blessings that come directly from him. That's all red letter. That's all his word coming forth in us. Amen. And nothing that he says ever comes back void. Nothing. Because whatever it goes forth into, it will come back and perform something. Amen? And it's life in us to those that believe. Amen? And that I'm excited about. Amen? So let's take a moment and... Mom, come here. Come with me. Okay? I'm going to ask if everyone would just come and stand and we'll all hold hands together. Amen? You know, so often, everybody sits in a place where everybody is separated from one another. Yeah, you got something? And together, you know, we're the body of Christ. Amen? And somewhere, some other place, there's a group of our body that is not here with us, but they're standing together. Amen? In the power of the Holy Spirit. And as we pray and we close this service today, we're going to pray for the fellowship in the Spirit. Amen? That we continue to grow in the grace and the mercy that God has intended for his church. Amen? So Heavenly Father, in Jesus' precious and glorious name, Father, we want to thank you for your presence and, Father, for teaching us, Father, through your Holy Spirit, what you want us to know, to hear, to receive, and to do and act on in Jesus' name. And Father, I pray for each one of us to follow you as you have called us to follow you as disciples of Christ, Father, in the release thereof, that the Spirit of God will live in us in such a powerful and mighty way that we will see revival, just as we sang in worship today, that revival needs to come in our lives. And it always starts first in us, Father, before we can see the spread. So as you started in us, Father, ignited us in us, Father, that it may spread throughout the land, Father, that you would cause us to be light and salt before the people. Father, we thank you for your love, your mercy, and your kindness towards us, Lord God, for thou art great in every way, and your faithfulness towards us. Father, bless each and every one here this morning that has heard from you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Lord, bless you all, and have an awesome week in the Lord. Coco, praise the Lord. So good to see you again. God bless you. Thanks for being here this morning. And have a great trip.
Great sermon. Thank you.
Amen.
Are you going somewhere? We are. We're going to North Carolina for a month.
Oh, great.
Yeah, this is our last one. We leave Friday.
I'm going to say, take a moment.